I'd like to bring to the stage or introduce Matt Baker, who is a professor of mathematics and associate dean at Georgia Tech. And he's an award-winning mathematician and math educator. He recently won a Simons Fellowship in mathematics, but he's also an accomplished magician. He's not only written a book of magic tricks, but he was named last year as the Greater Atlanta Magician of the Year. So not only has he won awards for teaching, but he's won awards for his magic, and I'm delighted that he's here to introduce tonight's presenter. So first, let me welcome Matt Baker.
All right, thank you very much, Cindy. And it is my pleasure to introduce tonight Dr. Colm Mulcahy. Colm is one of the most passionate advocates there is for the joys of recreational mathematics. And he's a professor at Spelman College, which is just down the road from where I teach at Georgia Tech. Colm has been a professor there for over 30 years. His writing has been featured in the New York Times, The Guardian, the BBC, and for 10 years he wrote a blog for the Mathematical Association of America, in which he featured some of his original card magic. And that was compiled into a book that Colm wrote, and I recommend it to you. It is called Mathematical Card Magic, 52 New Effects by Colm Mulcahy, published by CRC Press. So you'll be learning some of those effects here tonight. Now, Colm's passion for mathematics was inspired by reading the works of Martin Gardner, who many of you will be familiar with. Colm counted Gardner as a personal friend and vice versa. And Colm is now the vice president of the Gathering for Gardner Foundation, which seeks to preserve the legacy of Martin's contributions to the popularization of mathematics. Colm also had a 25-year friendship with the legendary math genius John Conway, who, as a number of you will know, passed away just a few weeks ago. And John was a great friend of the Museum of Mathematics. So we take this moment to remember him. And I wanted to give you a little demonstration as a bit of an appetizer for Colm's talk of one of the things John Conway used to love to do. So if you ever met John Conway in person, he may very well have showed you this. It was one of his favorite demonstrations. As everybody knows, let me go to different background where I think you'll be able to see this better. So as everybody knows, if you take a piece of rope and you don't let go of the two ends, then no matter what you try to do with mixing up the rope and going through and whatever, there is no way you can tie a knot in that piece of rope without letting go. And yet I saw Conway do the following thing. He never let go of the two ends of the piece of rope, but it was knotted. Now you probably didn't know what to expect there, and it goes a little bit fast, so I'll do it one more time for you. I'll show you the impossible. It's possible to mathematically prove that what I'm about to demonstrate for you is actually completely impossible, and yet there it is. Unfortunately, the margins of this Zoom call are too small to contain an explanation for what I just did. However, if you would like to know how that works, please check out my magic website, www.mattbakermagic.com. Go to the contact page, fill it out, send me a message, and I'll be happy to send you an explanation of that. So back to our feature presentation. In the next hour or so, Colm will demonstrate and teach three original card effects, including one which inspired a variation from Martin Gardner himself, and another one with which Colm learned directly from John Conway. So without further ado, please give a very warm Museum of Mathematics welcome to Dr. Colm Mulcahy.
Thank you very much, Matt. Great pleasure to be here. New York City is one of my favorite places in the world, and I wish I were there in person, but it's so nice to be able to join you all and people from various different parts of the US and indeed the planet. When we saw people logging in there, it was amazing how far afield some folks are. So thank you for joining us tonight. A big thank you to MoMath for this opportunity and to the Simons Foundation funding for making this possible. What MoMath does in general is amazing. What they've done in the last 6 or 7 weeks since having to shut their doors is even more incredible. They're reaching people all around the world now and sharing excitement about mathematics. When I see a deck of cards, I see a little laboratory in which you can do all sorts of wonderful explorations. Even if you're very young, you'll discover patterns and things that might make you ask questions that might make you do mathematics. So I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about what we will do in the next hour plus. As you can see here, my email address is there, and you're welcome to contact me if you want more information. I'm on Twitter at CardColm. I'm based here in Atlanta, Georgia. So what I'm going to do is show you four card tricks and teach you how to do at least pi of them. A pi is a number between 3 and 4, and it's not that important for us tonight what it is exactly, but it's more than 3. So I'll teach you 3 tricks and a bit of a 4th trick. You need to do a little more prep work to master the 4th one, but you will have all the information you need later on. I'll also ask you to think about extensions and variations on the tricks. So I'd like you to be creative, if not tonight, down the road, and think about some of the questions I'll ask, how you can stretch these tricks or make them work for different numbers or different patterns. The first trick is a very simple spelling coincidence that I stumbled on some time ago, and I sent it to Martin Gardner in a letter and found out a couple of years later that he actually had done something with it and turned it into a children's entertainment, a magazine that came out in 2007. The second one is probably the most complicated one mathematically, although it's not so complicated, but it has some very interesting aspects, and that might take us the longest to go through. The third one's very easy to do and a lot of fun for children, as is the first one. And the second one's good for children who can add numbers. And then I'll finish by showing you a trick that John Conway taught me about 20 years ago. So if you have a deck of cards or two, by all means, bring them out and try to follow along. Some of the tricks involve arranging a deck of cards, and that's why I myself have more than one deck here. One deck is fine. So there will be slides, which will be shared with you later. If you register online, you'll get an email after this session or tomorrow that will give you some web links, including some video links, and also some printable things and the slides. There's 40 pages of slides. So let me start by showing you a trick. And I'm going to go over to the green mat here, and we will see if we can make that big. If you can make this big on your screen, you'll see. You'll see I've laid out here an ace, a 2, a 3, a 4, a 5, and a 6. A nice little triangular pyramid using 6 values in the card deck. Ace represents 1 for us. Now, it doesn't matter about the suits. I just have different colors here, but it doesn't matter about the suits. What I'm going to do is pick these cards up in a nice natural order. Then I'm going to spell out their names, and they will magically appear exactly as I spell out their names. So here we go. I'm going to pick up the 6 and put it on top of the 3 and put that on top of the ace. So I've cleared out that diagonal. So once again, I'm picking the cards up in this order. You could also pick up the 6, place the 3 behind it, place the ace behind it. Same effect. Then I'm going to go for the second diagonal here and put the 5 behind the ace, and then the 2 behind that, and then finally pick up the 4. So let me show you again how I did that. I'm going to deal them out in order here and do it a second time. So I have my ace through 6 here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Pick up the 6, put it on top of the 3, put it on top of the ace, that's a diagonal. Then I go back here, put it on top of the 5, put it on top of the 2. I have 5 cards, put it on top of the 4. Now I turn the cards over. So the 4 is on top. Now if I spell out the cards' names, they will come on demand. So ace or 1, take your choice, has 3 letters in it. A, C, E. So I transferred 3 cards from top to bottom, one at a time, representing the 3 letters in the word ace. And then I take the next card and I turn it over. And yes, it is an ace. Let's see if that works again. Let's try spelling out 2. Card from top to bottom for each letter. T, W, O. 3 cards have been moved from the top to the bottom. I'll turn that over bravely, and yes, it is indeed a 2. How long will our luck hold out? Let's try for 3. Now, 3 has 5 letters in the word. We're spelling out the word in English. So we go T, H, or E, E. Yes, a 3. Well, it's looking good. Let's try for 4. Now, 4 has 4 letters. F, O-U-4. Where's the four? Well, there's only two cards left. So let's spell the word five. Word five has four letters. F-I-V-E. There's the five. And then you have to be very careful for the last one. S-I-X. There we go. We got a pyramid. This time it's upside down. But we got one, two, three, four, five, six. The cards came out in order. So I'll do it for you one more time. And then we'll take a look at the slides which summarize this. And you'll have access to those later. So I'm rearranging the cards here in the order. One, two, three, four, five, six in our triangular pyramid. I pick up this one, put it on top of this one, put it on top of this one. Then I pick those three up and I put them on top of the five, pick those four up, put them on top of the two. And then I pick those five up, put them on top of the four. So at this point I have four, two, five, ace, three, six. Then I turn the packet over. Now the six is on the bottom and the four is on the top. And then it just works, I promise you. A, Z, E, T, W, O, T, H, E, F, O, U, or F, I, V, E, and then the six at the end. But it just works out nicely. So if you have a deck of cards handy, I'll show you the slides now, and that should make it easier for you to be able to duplicate this. So here's what we start with. We start with this triangle of cards. Ace on the top, two, three underneath, four, five, six underneath that. And then the arrows, which are on this picture here, remind us what we're supposed to do next. We start in the bottom right corner. We put the six on top of the three on top of the ace, or if you prefer, put the three behind the six, then put the ace behind those two. Collect this row, which is a diagonal if you like, that diagonal, then this one, then this one. So you do it three diagonal, two diagonal, one diagonal. And that's summarized here. And when you turn the packet over, as mentioned, you have the four on top, two, three, ace, three, and the six on the bottom. And then the spelling just happens. It just works magically. About ACE, moving one card from top to bottom for each card. Better. And the next card, I promise you, is. And then if you repeat and spell TWO, again, moving three cards from top to bottom of the five cards now in your hand, next card will be a two. And then you do three. And you have to remember three has five letters. We're not counting out three cards, we're spelling out the number of letters in the word in English. Then it works out all the way. So this was published in a magazine called MUM under the title Curious Speller. And in that, Martin Gardner wrote about it the way I presented it, plus another way, where instead of having cards with the values and numbers on them, he had pieces of paper or cardboard with the words naming animals like elephant and dog and cat and so on. And that might be more fun for certain children, but it works out just fine. So there'll be a reference later on in the email you'll get, but if you look for it by just doing a web search on Martin Gardner's Curious Speller, you'll find the two-page children-friendly handout. Now this is not mathematics. It's a lucky linguistic break. A spelling surprise that happens because we spelled in English. How did I discover this? Good question. But as far as I remember, I said to myself, what order would the one through six have to be in so that if I spelled out, this would happen? I kind of reverse engineered it. And eventually I figured out what the order had to be, but it does depend on the English language. So the first question you might ask is, what if you just spell out the numbers instead of letters? So for five, if you did one, two, three, four, five, and for three, you did one, two, three. That's a different kind of a reverse engineer problem, and it's one that you'll be able to figure out if you try. But that's where it gets mathematical, trying to figure out how to get to the desired conclusion. Now, I got lucky because when I figured out the order the cards had to be in, with the four on the top and so on, I also figured out that maybe if I did them in this pyramid form and picked them up in that order, it would just happen automatically. Whatever order you find is necessary to get in a different language, or counting out the number of cards, you can figure out an order that works, and maybe you can also figure out a natural way to pick it up that doesn't seem forced. Now, we've only talked about the values. We have not talked about the suits. So maybe there's another interesting question is, could you spell out suits and flip over the next card and have a card of the right suit pop up every time? Maybe you can do it so you can do the value or the suit. Might be interesting. That's a different kind of an exercise. But these are all ways that you can try to figure out how to do tricks, invent your own tricks. Well, this is probably a good time to take a little break here and see if there are any questions so far about the Mark and Gardner.
Other questions?
In the Q&A, you can type them. There's a Q&A at the bottom of your screen. Feel free to type any questions you have. So far, no questions. So maybe we want to keep going. You did probably see an attendance survey pop up on your screen. We are happy to know how many people are joining us. The more the merrier. So please let us know how many people are watching with you. And let's keep going, and maybe some more questions will come up in a little bit.
Great. Well, that trick, as I mentioned, was taught to me. That's a trick that I shared with Martin Gardner, and he came up with some interesting twists on it. He also wrote a lot of books for children, as well as for adults. So I just want to briefly tell you a little bit about him before I do the next trick for you. Martin Gardner, I call the best friend mathematics ever had, because he wrote about mathematics for many decades and influenced generation after generation of mathematicians and computer scientists and game and puzzle lovers and magicians and so on. And he actually wrote 101 books, including a very famous one, The Annotated Alice in Wonderland. He loved children's literature, contributed to that genre himself. He also has some rather famous friends like artist Salvador Dali and M.C. Escher, many mathematicians and writers such as Carl Sagan and Isaac Asimov. And he's most famous for his Scientific American column, which he wrote regularly between the mid-50s and the mid-80s. That's a long time ago now, but those were still very worthwhile reading material. They were collected into many books, which you can even get on a single searchable CD-ROM. Great resource for teachers. Absolutely stunning material, every one a gem. So what I'd like to do now is another card trick for you. And to do that, I'm going to go back to cards. And let's take a look here. So I'm going to shuffle these cards, and then I'm going to need two volunteers. So maybe Matt and Cindy can help out here, because I'm going to have two people pick cards for me. We're going to have to do this, you know, over Zoom, so we'll figure out how to do that. So I'm going to take off, I just shuffled the cards, I'm going to take off the first five cards or so. And I am going to ask, I'm going to mix them up in a second, and then I'm going to ask Matt to tell me when to stop mixing, and then he's going to look at one of the cards, and I promise you I will close my eyes. Obviously I don't have to do that, but I will, because I don't want to know what the card is. And then we'll do the same thing.
Do you want to be off shared screen, or do you want to leave that screen on?
Right, if you turn your shared screen off, then we
get the full view of the cards.
I thought it was off. I'm sorry.
Good. There you go.
Well, I'm going to mix up these five cards, which I just took off the top of the deck after I shuffled it. And my eyes are closed, I promise. And I'm asking Matt in a second to tell me when to stop.
Stop.
Okay. Now, I want you to look at and remember that card. I cannot see it. My eyes are closed. I'm looking away and my eyes are closed. Look at and remember the card, suit and value. You got it?
Actually, my video disappeared, but someone else will remember it for me.
Okay, is Tim there?
Yes.
Okay, Tim, can you please look at this card that Matt
yes.
and remember the suit and value? I'm going to put it to the side. Now I'm going to mix up the remaining cards until Cindy tells me when to say stop.
Stop.
Okay, I'm turning up the next card. Now you look at that and remember it.
I've got it.
Suit and value. Now, you work at the Museum of Math, so I'm hoping I'm not going to stress you out if I ask you both to add together the values of the two cards you just looked at. And I will remind you that an ace counts as one, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. A jack, queen, and king count as 11, 12, and 13, respectively. So if you saw a 7 and a 6, you are going to tell me 13 in a few minutes. I want you to add up the value of the two numbers you saw. I'm now opening my eyes and putting the rest of the cards there. These are the two I'm trying to figure out what they are. So tell me, please, what the two numbers add up to.
I got 21.
I have 21.
21, okay. So it could be a jack and a 10. It could be a queen and a 9. Various other possibilities. It could be 2.
21,
you're right. So a jack and a 10 would be 11 plus 10. Or it could be a queen and a 9. It could be 2 10-and-a-halves. There's all these interesting possibilities. And then even if I knew what the numbers were, how could I possibly know what the suits are? But I'm going to put my money on it that the cards you picked were... okay, so who had the club?
That was you. Yeah.
That was who?
That was Cindy.
Cindy had the 8 of clubs, and the other card should be the King of Hearts. Am I right?
You are right.
And there they are, the 8 of clubs.
How about that?
And the King of Hearts. So that's interesting, because how on earth could somebody figure out what the two cards were for sure? Well, with mathematics and a teeny bit of magic, it can be done. And that's what I'd like to explain to you for the next 5 or 6 minutes. So let me do the trick again, or start doing the trick again. So I said at the beginning that I was going to take the cards and shuffle them, and this is what I did, but this time look very closely. Was that an honest shuffle? Yes and no. I certainly mixed up many of the cards, but if you look more closely and I go more slowly and I angle it this way, you will see that in fact I didn't shuffle all the cards. I made a point of dropping a lot of cards from the top, were in my right hand, on top last. So I disturbed most of the deck, but not the top cards. But that's kind of a fake false shuffle, because even though I said I was shuffling, that's a little fib, I was shuffling, but making sure that the top cards didn't change. Top cards might be something special. I'll come back to those in a minute. Now, what would be a good idea to have as the top cards? I'm going here to a different deck, and it's bigger so you can see the values. Well, what comes after one? Most people would agree that two comes after one, and after two, probably three, and after three comes four, and so on. Now, if I had an ace, a two, a three, and a four among the cards on offer, which I preserved through my false shuffle, I would be in trouble, because if somebody picked the two and the three, they would say your total was five. And if on a different occasion, somebody picked the ace and the four, they'd say their total was five, and I wouldn't know which was which. So if I'm going to use an ace, a two, and a three, I probably shouldn't use the four at all. Let's forget about the four. If I use an ace, two, three, and five, that gets more interesting. Maybe that might work. Now, I had 5 or 6 cards, so how about if I throw in another card?
Six.
Could I work with these cards just in terms of the values? We'll get to the suits later. I see a problem, because the ace and the six add up to 7, and so do the 2 and the 3. And that's ambiguous. So again, if two cards are picked and I'm told the total is 7, I don't know if it was the ace and the 6 or the 2 and the 5. So I probably shouldn't use the 6. Can I use a 7? Oops. Can I use the 7 in addition to the ones that are on the table? Addition being the key word. Well, again, we have an issue, because the ace and the 7 add up to 8, as do the 3 and the 5. So we probably can't use the 7. Maybe an 8 might be a good idea. Could I use another card, maybe a 9? Would that work? Or is there any ambiguity there in sums? If two cards are picked, is it possible to get the total two different ways? I think it might be, because the ace and the 9 add up to 10, and so do the 2 and the 8. So we can't use a 9, so we keep trying. Can we use a 10? It looks promising until you realize the 10 plus 1 is 11, which is the same total you get if you add the 3 and 8. So it turns out that the 10 doesn't work, and neither does the jack, because the jack and the 2, jack is 11, is 13, and so is the 5 and the 8. So it turns out, in fact, that those choices were not very good at all. At least we got off to a good start, but then we got off track. But now I'm going to tell you which numbers do work. For starters, they're not the only ones that work, but there certainly are some numbers that work. And I'm going to go back to my slides here and step you through this. So again, the trick as it appears is that the deck is shuffled and two people pick cards. You're told what the total is and you know what the cards are, not just the values. That's the trick as it appears and as I presented it. You'll be able to perform this shortly once I've explained a little more. So I call this an unaddition trick in a sense, because I was able to unadd. I was told the total was 21. And funnily enough, I immediately knew that it wasn't all the possibilities I had verbalized. I said it could have been a queen and a 9. I knew it wasn't. I said it could have been a jack and a 10. I knew it wasn't. I knew immediately that it was a king and an 8. And I'll tell you why in a second. Then the second question arises is, how did I know what suits? That's a whole different question. First secret is that if you use the right numbers, it is true that you can undo addition. From knowing what they add up to, you can figure out what they are. I've given you a tip off, and we'll get back to it shortly, as to what the numbers might be. Second secret, which I've also, I think, blown my cover on, is that I did a false shuffle. I planted at the top of the deck 6 cards at the very beginning, and I made sure my shuffle didn't disturb them. And even though I said I was shuffling, that was kind of misleading because I didn't shuffle the cards at the top. When I offered choice of cards to the two people, their choices were restricted to 2 cards from the special magic set of 6. Now, so you have 6 cards at the top and you keep them there through some fair looking but not so fair shuffles. The mathematics is about the numbers. I knew what the numbers were, but I also planted the cards there. And they're the same cards I always put at the top of the deck when I do this trick. The third secret is I have memorized the suits. I had a specific 6 cards with 6 numbers I knew would mathematically work. And I also memorized the suits. And I do the same suits every time. If you're doing this for young children, make your life easy and just take the same suit. Just work with all diamonds or all spades. And then it's a numbers game. But in performance, it's nice to do the version where you also apparently can divine the suits, but really you're not, you're memorizing the suits. So which cards are they? Well, I think you might have got a hint from what I showed you before. Some of you will probably have recognized the numbers. They're very special numbers called the Fibonacci numbers. So you start with 1, representing an 8, and a 2, and you add them to get 3, that already. And then you keep adding each one to the previous one. You add 2 and 3 to get 5, skipping over 4. You add 3 and 5 to get 8, skipping over 6 and 7. You add 5 and 8 to get, I didn't show you that one before, but that's 13, which for us is a king. We found that the 9 and the 10 and the 11 didn't work, the queen wouldn't work either. You've got to keep going until you get to a king. Now this idea of adding numbers in pairs, starting with 1 and 2, is a standard math kind of idea. And if you start with 1 and 2, you get the numbers that I'm interested in. Some people would start with 1 and 1. And they would start by saying 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3. I don't dispute that's a good idea. But it's not a good idea for cards. Because if I can figure out that somebody had an ace and something else, I need to know which ace it was. I don't want 2 aces in the game. So I'm going to use a single 1 and so on. Now you can keep going with this pattern. The Fibonacci numbers get quite big quite quickly. They start off, possibly a second one there if you like, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. My interest cuts off at 13. Card game. 13 is a king. But if you were to keep going, 8 and 13 is 21, 13 and 21 is 34, and so on. The numbers get big. But I'm not interested in the other ones. I am interested in a very specific ace, 2, 3, 5, 8, and king. And I call this trick the little fib trick because I'm using the smallest, the littlest Fibonacci numbers. And if you think of it, I also told a few little fibs at the beginning. I said, I'm shuffling the cards. Kind of, yes, maybe. And when I said I didn't know what the cards could be, well, I had a pretty good idea what they might be. All I needed to know was the total. So here's something that you probably don't know about Fibonacci numbers. I didn't know about it until fairly recently. I never learned about it when I was in school. You can write every number as a sum of Fibonacci numbers in a special, interesting way. Now, one is Fibonacci numbers. Everything can be written as 1 + 1 + 1. That's not very exciting. About whole positive numbers, and you can write them as a sum of Fibonacci numbers. Make a couple of ground rules. One is you never use a number twice. 1 + 1 is not what you want. And the second thing is you're never going to use two Fibonacci numbers beside each other. Now, when I say can be written as a sum, I'm quite happy if the number is a Fibonacci number. I'll mention that again in a few minutes. This was discovered fairly recently, 1939. And the guy who discovered it was an amateur mathematician. He wasn't a professional at all. He was in the medical field. Didn't publish it until 1972, and it wasn't noticed until a book called The Heart of Mathematics by Berger and Starboard came out about 20 years ago and made it more popular. If you think about it, there are other magic numbers that you can use to multiply together to get positive counting numbers, and those are called primes. 12 is 2 times 2 times 3. 15 is 3 times 5, and so on. Every number can be factored into primes, and you might have to use some factors several times, like 40 is 2 times 2 times 2 times 5 or whatever. But with Fibonacci numbers, it's a little different. We're doing addition, not multiplication. We're never using a number twice, and we're never going to use consecutive Fibonacci numbers. And when we say every number can be written as a product of primes, slightly inaccurate, because some numbers are primes. We just leave them alone. 19 is a prime. We're happy with 19. 13 is a Fibonacci number. We're happy with leaving 13 as it is. We don't want to write it as 5 plus 8, because that breaks the rule about consecutive Fibonacci numbers. But let's try out some Fibonacci numbers, writing numbers. So 6. If you write 6 as 5 plus 1, you've met your goal. Different Fibonacci numbers, and they're not beside each other. The other possibilities here are not legal. One of them uses 2 threes, which wouldn't happen in the card context. The other uses 3 numbers, which is 3 cards. I'm doing that anyway. N is 8 + 2. So how do you do it in general? It's pretty easy. You always yank off the largest number you can, the largest Fibonacci number less than it. So for 20, for instance, Fibonacci numbers, so 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 1. So 13 is the smallest one, the biggest one, I'm sorry, underneath 20. So you peel off 13 and you're left with 7, and then 7 can be written as 2 + 5. And that's actually the strategy. I'll show you some other examples here at the bottom of the page. Oops. Any number can be written as a sum of Fibonacci numbers, and you might need many of them. Like 51 turns out to need 4. Those are non-consecutive, different Fibonacci numbers. And if I added 145, I get a bigger number that would necessarily need 5. So you might have to use many, many numbers. But in our card game, we're only adding 2 at a time, and that's nice. Makes it much, much easier. So here are the cards that I work with. And they are, in fact, a very specific ace, and 2, 3, 5, 8, and king. And those have the advantage that I've memorized the suits, because I've worked with these for years. They're in a special order that mathematicians or card people sometimes like. It's called chased. The colors alternate, black, red, black, red, black, red. And chased is a representation of clubs, hearts, spades, and diamonds. I'll throw an in to make an English word out of it. And that's it. You take 2 cards from that, and you can tell what the numbers are by peeling off the biggest Fibonacci number, as I've just shown you. And the suits, well, you do have to memorize the suits. Again, if you're doing this for small children, just make your life easy and use an ace, 2, 3, 5, 8, and king of the same suit. And it's just a numbers game. The nice thing is any possible total can only arise in one way. That's why we couldn't use 1, 2, 3, and 4. Remember, 1, 2, 3, 4 was a problem because 1 and 4 was the same as 2 plus 3. That won't happen with these numbers. And as I said, it's pretty easy to decompose the number into the Fibonacci numbers from which you got by addition. The trick, once you know this, is not so hard to do. And this is the trick that if you do it for people, I really recommend you not explain it to them unless they have an interest in mathematics and they've tried thinking about it. Because once you tell people the secret, they tend to go, oh, is that all it is? But they probably were impressed the first time you did it. So just take the glory and move on and do another trick. Magicians in general shouldn't tell their secrets. But there's interesting mathematics here. If you're working with mathematics students, it's worth further. There are other numbers that work. For instance, a 2, a 1, a 3, a 4, a 7. So that's the same pattern here. You add two numbers to get the next one. The problem is you don't want 1, 2, 3, and 4 in the mix. So just chop off the 2. An ace, a 3, a 5, a 7, and a jack also work. And there are many other possibilities that don't seem to have the same pattern. So it's interesting mathematical questions. What numbers work and why? You'll notice these examples are always 5 numbers. I showed you 6 numbers. Then an interesting question is, what if 3 cards are picked and the 3 numbers are added up? Would the trick work then? I'll let you think about that. So this was published in 2008. And there is a number file video about it also, if you're interested. This might be a good place to pause and see if there are questions about this effect.
There is a question. Is this kind of summing with Fibonacci numbers related to Egyptian fractions at all? Writing proper fractions as sums of unit fractions.
That's an interesting question. I don't know. Egyptian fractions I only found out about after I did this, so I never went back to see if I could turn them into a card trick. The Egyptian fractions are fascinating. And again, it's a topic that we don't learn about in the standard curriculum. We kind of have to go the extra mile to find out about it. Very interesting question, but I don't know if there's a tie-in or if they can be used for card tricks. But if somebody finds it, please let me know.
Let's see, there is... what if the person you are doing it on gets past the first 6 numbers? I'm not quite sure what that means. Maybe you see something.
Let me show you the cards. I'll do the stop share and maybe you can highlight the cards. So I'm using these cards, a very special ace, 2, 3, 5, 8, and king. And I have those at the top of the package of cards. And I do a false shuffle and I say, I'm going to take off the first 5 or 6 cards. And I make sure that no other cards are on offer. So the cards that are taken off are these cards. Now I do genuinely mix them up. I have no idea. I lose track very quickly. And then in real life, a person picks one, looks at it, it's put down. A second person picks one, looks at it. Now we did it a little differently here because we're not in the same room. And then I ask what the total of the numbers on those 2 cards is. And as soon as I know it, I instantly know what the numbers are, and because I've also memorized the suits, I do know the cards exactly.
Does this work for large Fibonacci numbers?
Yes. The problem is a deck of cards is hard to work with for large Fibonacci numbers. So what you could do is use pieces of paper and just write down the first 100 Fibonacci numbers. They get very big very quickly. Write down the first 20 Fibonacci numbers on 20 different pieces of paper, put them in a hat, have 2 people draw out 2 pieces of paper, tell you what the total is. You have to memorize your Fibonacci numbers because if the answer is 372, you have to quickly figure out in your head. But it's not too hard because if you know your Fibonacci numbers, it's the number below it, then subtract it, and whatever's left must be another Fibonacci number. So yeah, you can adapt it, but I'm focusing today on things that naturally fall within the realm of a deck of cards where the values are 1 through 13. But yes, you can adapt it for non-cards.
All right, I think maybe we should move on.
Okay, is there anybody out there who likes ice cream? Matt, is your microphone working? Is your screen working? Might have dropped out of sight there. So we'll find somebody who likes ice cream. Because this is a trick where I ask you for your favorite flavor of ice cream and we'll see what happens. So I'm going to mix up the cards here and ask, how about Cindy? Do you like ice cream, Cindy?
I do.
What is your favorite flavor of ice cream?
I'm going to say chocolate.
Chocolate. That is, in fact, the best flavor of ice cream. My favorite flavor, too, and I'm looking forward to having some later on tonight. How many letters are in the word chocolate?
Is that nine?
Nine. So what would twice chocolate be?
18.
18. So we need enough to spell out the word chocolate, enough cards, and we don't want to overdo it and have more than twice that. So I'm going to pull off this number of cards, which I can see at a glance here is at least nine. Maybe there's 10 there. It doesn't really matter. I've got about 13, 14, 12, something like that. The number of cards I have is between nine, the number of letters in the word chocolate, and twice nine, which is 18. What's going to happen is I'm going to mix these up, and then I'm going to deal out three virtual scoops of chocolate ice cream and drop the rest of the cards on top. It's important that the topping be smaller than the scoop. So let's first of all mix them up. Can somebody tell me, maybe somebody tell me when to stop mixing? Maybe Tim can tell me when to stop mixing.
Stop.
Okay. So they're all good and mixed up. Right. So what we're going to do, as we said, is count out. C-H-O-C-O-L-A-T-E. That represents the word chocolate, spelled out letter for letter. Now, the number of cards I have left is supposed to be less than nine. It's getting awfully close. I'm going to take one or two off because I'm slightly worried. But don't worry. It doesn't really matter. As long as this pile is smaller than that pile, I promise you it's going to work. I now have five or six cards here. So this is the scoop. That's the scoop, which was nine cards. And that's the topping, which is smaller. So you do it two more times. C-H-O-C-O-L-A-T-E, second scoop, second top. And then I typically say, it's kind of boring dealing out cards. Keep the conversation going, and I say, Cindy, have you ever done magic before?
No, never.
No, amazing. She's never done magic before. She works in MoMath, but she's never seen or done any magic in her entire
life. I didn't say I haven't seen magic.
C-H-O-C-O-L-A-T-E, third scoop, third top. Now, this is where we're going to have some technical challenges here, but I'm going to ask Cindy to reach her hand out through her screen, and through a portal, through my screen, and touch the top card there. That looks like Cindy's hand to me.
It's just like my hand, absolutely.
And I want you to focus all your energy and turn that top card into, I don't know, the two of clubs?
Okay.
Wouldn't it be astounding if Cindy turned that card into the two of clubs?
I think I did it.
Okay, let's turn it over and see. It is, in fact. Oh, the two of spades.
Oh, no. Well,
operator, that's my fault. Operator error. You'll find out what I did in a minute. I made a slight boo-boo there. It was a black two.
Yes, that's what I was aiming for. Black.
That's
two.
What you were aiming for, yes. So, did I really make her turn the card into that card? No, apparently I knew that card was going to be there at the end. But that's interesting because a random flavor of ice cream was called out. Didn't matter how many letters were in it. If she'd said vanilla, that would have been seven. If she'd said strawberry, it would have been 10. I have to use a collection of cards that's between the size mentioned and twice the size mentioned. So for vanilla, 7 to 14 cards works. For strawberry, 10 to 20 card works. We had chocolate, so 9 to 18 card works. You spell out three times and drop, and apparently I know the top card at the end. So if I know the top card at the end, I must have had a peek at a card somewhere along the way. And you saw pretty much everything I did right in camera here. So you didn't see me looking at a card blatantly at any point. Actually, at the very beginning, and I obviously didn't do the best job, at the very beginning, I peeked at the bottom card and I mistakenly, in this poor evening light, thought I saw the two of clubs. And in fact, it was the two of spades. So if you're going to cheat, at least get it right. So again, the camera is in a position here which the person you're usually working with is not. The person you're working with is generally across the table from you. And if you're right-handed, you keep them on your right so that if you do a sneaky peeky on your left, they don't see it. But the camera is right there, so the camera sees all. In any case, you take a peek and then you mix the cards up. So what's going on? Am I mixing the cards up? I'm mixing up most of the cards, but I'm holding on to that one kind of carefully. So this is another false shuffle. And I'm telling a little fib by saying I'm mixing all the cards up because I am not mixing this card. I'm hanging on to that one for dear life. But somebody says stop and it doesn't matter. I still have that card at the bottom. So here's the surprise. The bottom card, which I've looked at and hopefully nobody else has seen, and I hopefully have read it correctly and memorized it, always becomes the top card when you spell out three times and drop. And there's a lot of flexibility because for chocolate, we had 9 letters. So between 9 and 18 cards would have worked. It doesn't matter if it's 14 or 17 or 12 or 15. And that's kind of nice. It's not, doesn't have to be that precise. So let me talk about on slides now what might be going on there. So I call this the ice cream trick, or sometimes the three scoop miracle, because you do in fact get three scoops. Okay, so hand out her deck for shuffling. A spectator is asked to call out her favorite ice cream flavor and she says chocolate. Isn't that extraordinary? My slides predicted exactly what was going to happen. You take the cards back, you take off about a quarter of them and you mix them further until you're told to stop. Of course, I keep at the bottom card. That part isn't mentioned here, but I've already told you the secret. You deal cards into a pile, one for each letter of the word chocolate, in this case, 9 letters. And then you drop the rest on top and you say that's the topping. And you do that spelling topping routine 2 more times. You always do it a total of 3 times. And then you say, I didn't know what was, you picked the ice cream flavor. I didn't control that. I don't even know how many cards I have. You mix them up at the beginning. And I made you turn it into, in this case, it says the 4 of spades and the 2 of spades when we did it a few minutes ago. So it looks like I performed a miracle. And this trick was published to mark the beginning of the card column series of blogs, which ran for a decade. And it happened to be Martin Gardner's 90th birthday. So there's also a video, a number file video, where you can find out what's going on here. But I'm going to show you a quick explanation, and the slides, which you'll see later, will have more detail if you're interested. I'm going to show you a quick explanation of what's really going on here. And I'm going to do it with a picture. The picture is this picture. So in this picture here, I have a representation of a packet of 13 cards. Now, I don't know if I had 13 a few minutes ago. Maybe I did, maybe I didn't. Here, I'm pretending I've got 13. And imagine them arranged in order from ace, 2, 3, all the way down to king. So the bottom here represents the initial stack of 13 cards, ace, 2, 3, down to king. And the bottom one is the one I want you to focus on. It's the king, it's the darkest panel. Now I was asked to spell chocolate. Then for a second, I've been asked to spell mint chip. Mint chip is 8 letters. So had I been asked to spell mint chip, I would have counted out 8 cards, which is these ones here, to the table, reversing the order. So the white one, which would be the ace, would go to the bottom, and then above it, the next light, and so on, up to there. So reversing these 8 gives me this. And then the 5 on the bottom, that's 13 minus mint chip, 13 minus 8 is 5. The 5 on the bottom get jumped on top as the topping. And there's the topping, the bottom of the original deck, which I peeked at, the bottom of the original packet of 13, card that I'm going to predict at the end, of course, goes in there as the bottom of the first topping. At this point, it's easy to lose track of it. The pictures will help because the second time you also spell out mint chip, which reverses the order of those 8 cards. And what does that do? It puts them here in reverse order. And then you drop the new remainder on top. So the ace is now 5 cards down, if that had been the ace originally. And now you can see that magic happens if you do it 3 times. Because if you count out those 8 cards, mint chip, a third time, and drop the topping on top, top of the topping is the original bottom card, the one that I pretend it was a king. So the bottom card moves from that position to that position to that position. That's hard to keep track of, but it always, I promise you, moves to the top after you've done it 3 times. And that's why the bottom card always comes to the top. And that was assuming mint chip, which was 8 letters. What if we had done chocolate with 13 cards, which maybe is what we actually did. But you have to redraw the picture, but I promise you it worked out the same way. And if she had said vanilla, which would have been 7 letters, and I happened to pick 13 cards, you'd have to read things a little bit here, but it's always going to work. The important thing is that you're spelling out more than half the cards. And that's why the topping has to be smaller than the flavor. So if somebody says mango, that's only 5 letters. You'd only have 8 or 9 cards. It's a little claustrophobic. Go for something like, you know, vanilla, strawberry, chocolate, mint chip. You want to have 12, 15 cards to make it a little bit interesting. So when you deal out 3 times and drop, the bottom card comes to the top. That's the secret. You peek at the bottom card. You have to see it correctly and make sure nobody else sees you peeking. And you have to remember it. Memorizing it is tricky. Do it over and over, but you remember it. And then later on, after you've had the 3 deals, drops and deals, you say somebody pressed down hard at the top. That's just showbiz. It's got nothing to do with mathematics. It's just to keep it interesting. Press down hard at the top card and turn it into, and then you casually mention one that you saw at the beginning. You have to have read it correctly. I goofed. I saw it was a black 2 and I wrong black 2. It helps if you get it right and it helps if you remember it. And then you say, I wonder if you could do me a favor and turn that top card into, and then when they do it, you say, you've done magic, that's amazing. And everybody gives them a round of applause. That's how it works. Before we leave this picture, I want to draw your attention to one other thing. So we got from here, the initial stack, to here, to here, to here. Not only is the bottom card, the original bottom card, now at the top, but the one underneath it, which would have been the queen there, is underneath here. It went from being second from the bottom to second from the top. And the one that was third from the bottom went from the top. Actually, more than half of them are back in reverse order at the other end of the deck. That means if you're really smart and quick-eyed and have a good memory, you can peek at the bottom 2 cards. And you can have the first card identified and have a second person press on the next card. And if you remember it correctly, you'll get credit for being doubly magic. One final thing I want to draw your attention to. Imagine if we took a deck, a packet like this in order, and we did 1, 2, 3. Imagine if we went for a 4th. For the 4th time, the bottom card, which was on top after 3 of these operations, would of course end up on the bottom. Actually, if you reverse the order of these 8, putting them here and dropping that on top, you're back to the beginning. In other words, if you spell out more than half a packet of cards and drop the rest on top 4 times, I promise you, everything is back in the order it started in. And that's really nice. And magicians can use that for kind of a false shuffle and so on. This is an operation which looks complicated, and it is. But if you do it 4 times, it's as if you hadn't done it at all. So before I open the floor up to questions here, some possibilities that you might want to explore. I've already answered the first question for you. Are more cards predictable? Yes, you can predict the top 2 or 3 cards, provided you peeked at them and remember them. Are there other things you can do with this principle? For instance, can you generalize it in other ways? I had the same flavor spelled out 3 times. Here's a surprise. If we had done chocolate twice and vanilla once, it would also have worked. Now, it depends on when you count vanilla, when you count chocolate. I'll let you think about that. But if 2 of the 3 deals, the ice cream flavors, are the same and the other one's different, within some limitations, it's still going to work, which is really nice. And we have a trick here which takes the bottom card to the top. So mathematically, you might say, well, maybe I can do the opposite. Maybe I can do some kind of dealing, dropping thing that takes the top card to the bottom if you do it 3 times. That's a challenge for you to think about. Okay, so let's stop for a second and see if we have questions about this trick or how it works or why it works or how it's performed.
There is a question here. Is this trick related to the curious speller trick?
That we started with?
Yeah, I suppose so, yes.
Yeah. No, I think it is not. I'll tell you why I think I was inspired by it. It is related to a trick called Jim Steinmeier's 9-card speller. That's a trick where you take 9 cards and you spell out the value of a card that you've chosen, and surprising things happen. Jim Steinmeier's nine-card speller. But I don't think it's related to the first one.
All right, one more question here. This goes back maybe to the previous problem. How do you exactly shuffle the cards so the cards you want that you set up don't accidentally mix when you shuffle fast?
Yeah, so well, if I do it again here, can you see, can you highlight that screen so everybody can see my hands and the cards?
Yes.
So, you know, somebody has said vanilla and I have cards in my hand and I fan them out to check that I've got at least seven cards and no more than 14. Of course, I have peaked or I now peak. It's a four of hearts. Let me turn it over. Now, you wouldn't do that in real life, of course. But the point is now you know exactly where it is. So then I say, well, I'm going to mix these cards up. And look what I'm doing. I'm holding on to that with a couple of fingers. And I'm just making sure that that doesn't move. And I'm moving the rest around. So it's a false shuffle, which is a very minor skill in the great scheme of sleight of hand. I can't do real sleight of hand, but I can do this. So I'm just holding on to that. It's not so obvious when it's face down. In fact, most people wouldn't suspect it. But I have made sure that I held on to that one card. Now, of course, if you're doing a trick where you want to identify the two bottom cards, you have to hold on to two. But that's an extra level of sophistication.
One last question. Why can't you use a flavor less than six letters again? I know you had mentioned that.
It just gets small. Like sometimes people would say rum. Now, if people say rum, you have to use between three and six cards. It's very small. I mean, counting out and dropping, there's almost no, it's just too claustrophobic. There's no elbow room. I find mango confining, or peach. Peach is common in Georgia. And, you know, you might only have seven cards or eight cards to start with. Spelling out five, dropping one or two. It looks better, I think, when you've got 10 or 12 cards.
All right.
You can try it with a small flavor, but I think rum is definitely too small. Somebody says rum, I make them say rum raisin.
Okay.
Okay. So let me tell you a little bit about this gentleman, John Conway, who passed away just a few weeks ago. And was a great friend of MoMath and visited many times. He was a professor at Princeton for the last 30 plus years. He did all sorts of extraordinary mathematics, and there are hundreds of videos of him and many number five videos. He's worth looking up because he's such an entertaining guy, and he did all sorts of deep mathematics and fun mathematics, and he managed to mix the two in ways that very few people have succeeded in doing. He also liked coincidences, so when his biography came out a few years ago and I asked him to sign it for me, he was happy to do so because he noticed that Conway and Colm Mulcahy both began with C-O and ended with Y. So he very carefully wrote this out for me. And it's a great book. I highly recommend it. And this drawing is an old drawing of him from the 1970s with weird math growing out of his head. And in any case, he came to recreation math conferences at MOVES over the years. And I should be going forwards, not backwards. There we go. So this was the last one that he was at, I believe, in August 2017. And there he is playing with a magic trick involving decks of cards, which I can't explain to you today. But he was a great guy. And about 20 years ago, he showed me a card trick, which I'd like to show you. There's various stages of performance, and I'm going to demonstrate for you the early stages in some detail and explain it, and then I'll do the fancier version at the end, and the slides will explain the detail if you wish to pursue it further. So I'm going to start off here with a deck of cards, which I'm going to take out of the box. And these are cards, you know, just a regular full deck of cards. It is important here to play with a full deck. It isn't always the case, but it is important here for this trick. And what I'm going to do is deal out some cards into a pile, which is what we've been doing when we spelled ice cream trick. But I'm going to deal out a lot. I'm going to speed up so that we're not taking too long. I'm going to do it until I'm about halfway through the deck. So, you know, maybe I've dealt out roughly half. Yeah, roughly half. But I want to shuffle these together. And I'm going to do it. Now, a card just moved, and that's a problem. I have to check which end that moved from. I'm sorry. I think we're good. Sorry about that. Yeah, sorry about that. No, you weren't supposed to see that. the order of the cards turns out to be important. But I am going to shuffle them now. I'm going to shuffle them like this. I'm going to do a riffle shuffle where they're intertwined with no great regularity. There is a possibility of a perfect shuffle. I don't know how to do that. It's very hard to do that. So they're just shuffled. And then I'm going to tell you that even though I've shuffled these cards, I can do some magic. For instance, I can produce a red card and a black card. Now, without looking. Now, it's important that you don't know at first how I'm doing this. In real life, I would probably put the cards behind my back or under the table. I'm going to take them slightly out of view here. My other hand is here, and I'm just going to reach over and find a red card and a black card, and let's see if I succeeded. I think I did. I think I got a red card and a black card. Okay. Now, if you take two cards at random off the deck, there's a 50-50 chance that they're different colors and a 50-50 chance that they match. So I can do this many times. That'll be kind of interesting. Let's try again. Yes, I succeeded again. Let's try again. Amazing. What's going on here? Well, I'll tell you in a few minutes, but I can keep doing this until we all get very tired. Now, what I've done there is pull off two cards of different colors every time. Let me be a little more ambitious. Let me try to pull off four cards. Not only are the two of them red and two of them are black, but all four suits are represented. So again, I'm going to reach over here to where the cards are, and with my skilled hands, I'm going to produce diamond, a spade, a heart, and a club. So you can do it two at a time, you can do it four at a time. Wow. Let's try again. A heart, a club, a spade, and a diamond. So you get the idea. I can do this. Now, what am I really doing? That's an interesting question. Well, I put the cards out of sight so you wouldn't see how easy it was. Because all I'm doing is just taking off the top two cards. Even though you shuffle the deck, I promise you that the top two cards and the two underneath those and the two underneath those are always of different colors. That seems impossible unless you've seen the principle before or you stop and think about it. The next two are also of different colors. Not only that, if you pull them all four at a time, you'll always get four different suits. Well, that's not quite true. And in fact, when I said it first two at a time, you have to be careful. First and second card are always different colors. The third and fourth card are always different colors. I can promise that the second and the third are different colors. But I have taken off, if I counted correctly, 16 cards now, and that's a multiple of four. So as long as I stay in multiples of two for colors, or stay in multiples of four for suits, I'll be able to pull off four in a row without looking, and they are different suits. There they are. Now, if I take off two to show off my skills on color, and then I try pulling off four, I might mess things up. Let's see. A diamond, a spade, another diamond, and a club. So it didn't work there, but the reason is I broke rank. If I take two more off, I'll be back in sequence, and then I think the next four are going to work. Yes, four different suits. So what do you have to do to make a deck of cards do this? Well, it's very simple. You start off with a deck of cards, which is in a special order. I'm going to put these cards aside, and I'm going to show you what that order is with a different deck. I brought a few different decks with me. I'm going to start off with this other deck here. And these are red. And this has been rigged from the top, clubs, hearts, spades, diamonds. That's our friend Chased, the Chased order. And then clubs, hearts, spades, diamonds. And then clubs, hearts, spades, diamonds. Clubs, hearts, spades, diamonds, and so on. So I have 13 sets of four, where each of the sets of four is in a very specific order. A very specific order. Now, they won't come out in that order after I've shuffled. But let's see what happens. So I deal out about half the package. I'm going to speed up here if I can. Now, I did the riffle shuffle before. Let me show you a variation on the riffle shuffle, which is easier if you have small hands or if you can't do a riffle shuffle. What I'm going to do is twirl these cards. It helps to have them on a surface like this mat and not a shiny table, turning them into what are called rosettes. And I'm just going to smush the rosettes together. That's very easy to do, and small children can do that even if their hands are small relative to the cards. It's similar in principle to the riffle shuffle. I promise you that if I peel off four cards, they will be different suits. Now, they're not in the same order that they went in it. They went in the order chased. Now I'm getting clubs, hearts, diamond, spades. But I did promise four different ones, and that's in fact what I've got. And then if I do it again, they came out in a different order. I can't promise you what order they came out in, but I can promise they're the right cards. That is how many cards? Eight. We'll do another set. That's another four, and again, they're all different. But now comes something very, 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 very surprising. Imagine if I took off 13 cards. I promise you, I'll never get two of the same value, get an ace through king in some order. Here they come. You put the ace back there, and when I put the two out, when I find the two, I'll put it on the top. Here's the two, there's the two. So I got ace, two, three, four, five, six, seven. The eight's missing. It must be the next card. There it is. Eight, nine, ten, jack, queen, king. Isn't that amazing? I peeled off 13 cards, and I got the ace through king with various suits. So we have a triple treat here, because two at a time we're getting color. Four at a time, provided it's one through four, five through eight, nine through 12, or whatever, four suits. And 13 at a time will give you 13 different values, but you have to be slightly careful. It has to be the first 13 cards or the next 13 cards or so on. I dealt off 12 earlier, and when you weren't looking off camera, I took one card away, so that actually I had taken off 13 cards, and that was how I knew that the next 13 were going to be of different values. So that's part of what John Conway would do when he would do this trick. He would perform the two miracle, the four miracle, and the 13 miracle. Let me show you one more version of it, and then we'll be done, and I'll show you a little bit of explanation on screen. Again, I have another version of the deck here, and for this, is Tim still with us?
Yes.
Okay, I would like you to shout out your favorite number, please, in a few minutes between 1 and 13. In the meantime, I need to shuffle the cards. So I've got another deck of cards here. You can guess how it's rigged. I'm going to show you the rig on a slide in a minute, but I'm going to peel off about half. I'm going to do two rosettes. I'm going to mush them together. And now, Tim, a number between 1 and 13, please.
Six.
Six, okay. So I'm going to see if I can guess what the sixth card is. Would that be impressive?
Yes.
Okay, I am going to cheat, however. I'm going to look and see what the first five cards are and some of the cards after it. But that's still pretty impressive, I hope. So there's the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, Tim's, which is the sixth, the seventh, the eighth, ninth, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and so on. I'm going to see if I can guess what the face down card is. And you might be able to guess it too if you realize what we have actually learned in the last little while. Let me do the math now in my head. So I am seeing that that card is obviously the, let's see. Yes, it's the four of clubs would be my guess. So let me see if it's the four of clubs. It's the four. Ah. Now, the question is, how did I know it was the four of clubs? And the answer is by a process of elimination. Looking at the first four cards, I see all four suits represented. Then I see five, six, which I don't know what it is, seven and eight. So looking at five, six, seven, and eight, I can see that the four suits should be represented here, but the club is missing. So I knew it was a club pretty quickly. To figure out which club it is, I have to look at the first 13 cards. And I deliberately dealt out more than 13 because I didn't want people to notice that, you know, you see two jacks now and it doesn't arouse any suspicion. But I don't see any fours at all. So the four should have been in the first 13 cards. it should have been a club. So indeed, it should be the Four of Clubs. So I know that was a lot to digest, but I'll go back to the slides and quickly give you the setup. And again, you can take a picture of this screen if you wish. It'll be in the notes, which you'll get later on. But what used to happen, once Conway showed me this trick, I used to carry a rigged deck with me. And if I ran into him at a conference, he'd always be holding court and doing stuff with students and amazing and amusing people. And I would say, can you do a card trick for us? And I would give him my deck of cards, which was pre-rigged. And he would act real innocent and say, oh yes, I'd love to do a card trick. People would think he'd been handed a deck that he didn't know anything about, but of course the deck was rigged. And then he could perform various phases of this trick. So that's how we used to do it. Now, he had a particular arrangement of 13 cards. I already told you what the color arrangement was and the suit arrangement. He used a particular arrangement of the 13 card values, and he remembered it based on this mnemonic. It almost sounds like an old English nursery rhyme or something. The five tenacious boys nicely joke to hated servant girls sick for absent king. You can memorize this looking at it for a few minutes, and here's what it represents. It represents the 13 term sequence of card values. The five is three, five. Tenacious is 10 and ace, two words. Boys, well, those are jacks. Nicely, the best he could manage was nine, for nicely for nine. Joke, joker, two, the number two. Hated servant, girls, eight, seven, girls are queens. Sick, six, four, the number four. Absent, nothing. Kings, king. So the word absent is in there to make it more sensible when you memorize it, but actually it doesn't represent anything in cards. It's just a little inside joke. Now, we don't use the jokers. He had another version of the trick where he had jokers involved. I don't use the jokers. And the word absent isn't really there. So I'm just going to do a three, a five, a 10, an ace, a jack, a nine, jump to two, and so on. Then if you do that 13 cycle for a deck of cards, simultaneously with a four cycle, clubs, hearts, spades, and diamonds, four and 13 are relatively prime. So if you do that, you're going to go through the deck once. And what you're going to get is the following. This is the crib sheet you need. If you want to take a picture of a slide, this is the one. This is all the information you need. You rig the deck so it starts off three of clubs, then does five of hearts, then 10 of spades, ace of diamonds, jack of clubs, and so on. By the way, the easiest way to do this in real life is to go back to the mnemonic and make a pile of threes, and beside it a pile of fives, and beside it a pile of tens, and a pile of aces, and a pile of boys. Just take the whole deck and deal it out so that you get piles in that order. And then you can go back and pull out the three of clubs and put the five of hearts on top of it, face up. Then later on, you'll flip them over. First two times you go through, it's a little painful, and then it speeds up a lot. So it takes about 5 minutes of practice to set the deck up. That's it. That sequence makes that trick and all the variations on it possible. And I guess there's more detail here in the slides, but we're out of time. So that's the rosette shuffle idea, that you, instead of doing the riffle shuffle, you twirl them into rosettes and then push your hands together. So in closing, I have some more references here. If you're interested, you will get something in email a little later, probably tomorrow, with these slides and links to the videos I mentioned, and two places where you can print out children-friendly handouts on the two easier tricks. And in closing, you can also find it not only on the web, but in my book, which came out 6 or 7 years.
So I think I've got three questions, I think, that we might have time to run through. This is a specific one about the last puzzle, the last problem. Does the sequence of 13 work for each set of 13 cards? Could I do 13 tricks of two of different colors, so 26 cards are on the table, then do a sequence of 13? I don't profess to understand that. But
right. Well, my deck was rigged in the Conway way, which meant that when you first look at it, you just see red, black, red, black, red, black. If you look a little closer, you see it four suits, four suits, four suits. If you pay a lot of attention, you realize that simultaneously it's 13 values in some order. It doesn't have to be Conway's order, followed by the same 13 values in different order, and so on. So the way you can present it is deal off pairs. After you've done the dealing out and shuffling, one shuffle, deal out pairs in such a way that you do two at a time and you have to keep track, and then you do four at a time. And once you get to 26, once you get halfway through the deck, you can switch to 13. What I did, that would have taken too long. So what I did was I did four, after I'd shown you the two, I did 4-4-4, and then sneakily I removed a card so that I broke into a 13 sequence. I wanted the first 13 cards out of the way, and only 12 of them were gone when I did 3-4s. But you can mix if you're careful.
All right, actually, I may tag on a couple more. We do have a little headroom here. Does the shuffle have to be perfect?
It's not a perfect shuffle in the sense that things are interwoven. I don't have those skills. That's a whole different realm of mathematics and magic. They're not interwoven like the way your fingers might be if you did this. They're just sloppily. And I mean, it's very sloppy if I do a riffle shuffle. And if I do a rosette shuffle, I'm just smushing these piles into each other. So it's definitely sloppy and not perfect.
All right, very good.
But so, only one such shuffle.
Here's a fun question. Who made you want to do magic and math?
Well, I'll be honest. I was never interested in magic when I was young, not in the slightest. I'll tell you about the best magic trick ever. And I heard about this trick about 20 years ago, and I got interested in it, and I thought about it, and that's what got me interested. And the trick is the following. I'll give it to you in a way slightly different from the way that I was told it. But let's pretend poker is a game that people play for fun, and it involves five cards. So let's suppose you and I were playing poker, and we called up a friend, and he said, oh, you wouldn't believe the poker hand I got last night. And he told us four of the cards he had, and then the phone went dead, and you didn't hear the fifth one. Well, if he had played his cards right, no pun intended, if he had been strategic in how he told you his five cards, telling you the first four cards would have been enough information to you automatically to know what the fifth card is. That sounds impossible. So let me say it one more time. Suppose I was going to try to communicate to you five cards from a deck, and I was worried that the phone line was going to drop after four. If I plan ahead and tell you the cards in a particular order, it doesn't matter if the phone line goes dead after I've said the fourth card. It is possible to communicate the identity of five cards by telling somebody what four of them are. That blew my mind when I heard it, and I had to think about it for a few days. And when I figured it out, I was thrilled. And I started going back and reading things like Martin Gardner, who had written about tricks like that. And the first card trick I ever invented, it is literally the oldest trick in the book, in my book, is one where you scale it down to four cards. Somebody is trying to communicate to you four cards, and they only manage to communicate information about three before the line goes dead. And you still figure out what the fourth card is. Those are communication tricks. So they involve mathematical communication. They're more sophisticated than what we've done today. They require two people who understand, speak the same language, the same mathematical language. And they're a lot of fun, but it's more sophisticated. But that's how I got interested in it. And then eventually I just spent a lot of time dealing out cards and looking for patterns and spotting cute numerical language patterns, which was, you know, the spelling trick at the beginning and then the ice cream trick. If you play around with something long enough, and you have a passion for it, you might get lucky and stumble on something, and that's what happened to me. But to be honest, I didn't do it as a young person at all. People who are really good at this stuff start young. People who are good magicians tend to start when they're, you know, 10, 14. That's why I can't do sleight of hand. I didn't start when I was young.
I'm sure there are a lot of 10 and 14-year-olds out there watching you right now, so maybe somebody's going to be inspired. On a related question, how familiar is the average professional mathematician with these kinds of mathematical tricks?
I would say not that familiar. Martin Gardner was well aware that having education is no inoculation against being fooled easily. People sometimes think, oh, well, I've got a degree in this, that, you won't fool me. Mathematicians and scientists are quite easy to fool with magic tricks. They don't have much expertise or experience. They don't know what to look out for. I mean, simple things like false shuffles. I now know to look out for false shuffles because I do a little bit of it myself, but I don't catch a lot of things that people do. I mean, there's some interest in the math community, but I would say a lot of mathematicians, you know, probably don't know it. They might be more interested if they knew that there was interesting mathematics involved. And there's another wonderful book out there by two mathematicians called Diaconus and Graham. It has more sophisticated mathematics and more sophisticated magic than I've shown you tonight. But it shows you that some really high-powered mathematicians can apply magic principles to discover magic, and magical investigations give rise to math questions, which can give rise to serious math, which you go off and explore and papers on. So there is a good interaction there, but I think it's a small community, but a very vibrant one.
Well, Colm, thank you so much for a wonderful, entertaining evening of Mathemagic. It was great.
Well, thank you. And I want to thank MoMath again and Simons Foundation for the opportunity. And if you are one of the people out there who've enjoyed this, remember that MoMath is doing far more than they ever promised anybody they do. They're reaching out now across the globe, not just people who walk in their door in Manhattan. And they deserve your support. They reach a lot of children and inspire a lot of people. So please check out their website and become a member, or find some way to support them so that they can reach more and more people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Colm. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. Hope to see you again at another program soon.